so pleased to be here with Jackie Warren at Blue Jazz Nightclub. She plays here every Wednesday from 8 to 11 when she's not traveling all around the world. Jackie is an amazing jazz pianist who plays Latin music, Latin jazz, straight ahead jazz, you name it, she can play it. And Jackie is with us on Wednesdays here. She also plays at the Nighttown, the late night piano bar from, what is it, 11 to?
10:30 to 1.
10:30 to 1 on Fridays and Saturdays. So Jackie, I want to know a little bit about like how you got into this business.
Wow, well I learned to play piano from my mother.
She was
my
first teacher. She was your
first teacher? Yes. And she did not teach me jazz though. I learned most of my jazz from the television. All in the Family theme song or whatever. I'm from Colorado, so we don't have a lot of jazz there. But my parents, actually, they both play piano, and they did take me to some ragtime bars, so I got a little taste of the Scott Joplin.
Tell me, like, how you made that transition. What was she having you play as her teacher?
Well, we would play ragtime and some, like, classical things, but I wasn't trying to read all the music. I was copying off my older brothers and sisters who all play, and my mom was their teacher as well, and I ended up hooking up with a teacher in Colorado Springs that a friend of mine took lessons with, a super cool lady. Her name was Myra Boitis, and I'm sort of becoming her, and she's predicted my whole life for me that I would become a jazz musician, and I would travel around the world, and I would record and just have the best.
So she told you that as a student?
Yes, and that lady, Myra, is the one who played me my first Oscar Peterson record. I was like blown away. I was like, oh my God.
How old were you then?
I was 14, so a little bit of a late bloomer for jazz, I guess, but
I don't know. You could have been playing in bars much before that.
I wanted to play in bars so bad when I was a kid, but we did go to a ragtime bar and I got to play in there a little bit. So.
And then how did you get to Cleveland?
Well, actually the same lady, Myra Boitis, said, need to study classical music, and I eventually came to the area to go to Oberlin Conservatory to study. So, but I just want to play jazz the whole time. I mean, I really enjoyed my classical studies.
Oh, and they have a wonderful jazz studies program there now. I don't know if they did bad things.
Oh yeah. I mean, the same gentleman who was had started the jazz program there was my mentor and teacher, Mr. Wendell Logan, and I actually ended up teaching there for about 5 years and. I taught his class for him. He hired me because he was ill, and he asked if I would teach his arranging class. I'm like, oh my God, it was so cool. So it was neat to go back and influence the students the way that I had been influenced jazz-wise too.
And you are such an amazing player, and there aren't a lot of female jazz players. I mean, you're growing up, there probably were even fewer, right?
It's like zero. So
so you're a trailblazer.
I guess.
I met you originally when you played with our area's Joshua Zepka.
I'm
a huge fan of. And the first time I ever saw you play was with him. And then I've seen you play all over around town. But you're playing now in Cuba, in New York, in Boston, in D.C. You're going back to Cuba again. So
yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Oh my goodness. Actually, it was a total sort of accidental thing that happened for me to go there. I had been once before, like years ago, with a saxophone player, my best friend, Binda Keidel. Her mother took us. She's like, it's high time you girls went to Cuba. I had went to Oberlin with Binda. But we only got to spend like 4 or 5 days there. But this deal was, I actually was playing at Nighttown one night, and this lady walks in and she started singing a Cuban song that I was playing. And this is my new best friend, Patricia Busset. She's a Venezuelan lady. And we were talking about, like, I started teaching her kids piano and we just hit it off. And we were talking about what our biggest dream would be to go to Cuba. We had the same dream. And then it happened because her friend is dating this Cuban singer who's Miguel Cuny is his name. Friend is Julie Hutchison, who is now my friend. And I met them all for the first time, Julie and Miguel, in the Havana airport. I just like flew there by myself. And we were invited to be guest artists at this festival in Pinar del Rio, which is all the way on the west side of the island. And it was the most fabulous experience ever. We got to go in the School of the Arts. We got to, it was my job to sit in with every band in the festival. So I was like, oh, I loved it. It was so
wonderful. I remember I saw you right when you came home and you were still so like buzzed about it. You were so excited.
And I still am.
And now you're playing with those women in a new trio called the Jazz Divas, right?
Well, now that's, a whole different group that I actually joined forces with them through Maurice Hines and the Diva Jazz Orchestra when they came to Cleveland to present Maurice's show, Tapping Through Life. It's a story of...
he and his brother,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and...
Gregory Hines.
Talk about...
I worked with Gregory Hines a little bit in television. He's the loveliest
really?
Guy.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I mean, Maurice
was so
is also
sad
lovely.
When he died.
Oh, I know, and it's... The show is really cool because... you get to see all like their children's photos and like their first tap shoes and his photos. I mean, it's their whole life story, what they went through, and it also features another pair of brothers, the Manzari brothers, John and Leo Manzari, who were about 21, 22, and so their story is sort of paralleling, you know, Maurice and Gregory's story, and then the whole thing is accompanied by Sherry Miracle, the music director, and a 9-piece, all women. Jazz orchestra called the Diva Jazz Orchestra.
And so you're in two diva groups.
Yeah, because Sherry has had like a diva big band for like 25 years now in New York, all women at all times, and because it's so hard for women to get
gigs
and featured on things, like, you know, a lot of times, you know, there's discrimination. So like, she's like, well, you know, I'll just start my own thing. And then now there's various offshoots of the band. So I'm not in the big band, although I've subbed in there, but I'm in the show band. We met in Cleveland and I've been with them ever since. And then we just had so much fun. Like every day before the show, the bass player, Amy Shook, and Sherry on drums, and myself, we would just show up early and say, okay, well, we're warming up. I'm like, wow, we may as well just start a band because we had such chemistry. And so now we're the three divas and we're touring all over. I think we're going to play actually the Cork Festival in Ireland.
Oh my gosh.
Next year. I know.
That's awesome.
I'm so excited. Oh my God.
And so you're a regular here in Cleveland, but I know that New York has been calling. Are you going to go back and forth now?
Well,
Louisville's calling.
I love my Cleveland. I just love the people in Cleveland and Akron, and
there's so many great musicians here.
There really are. I mean, but New York is calling. New York is very expensive to live there, as I'm sure you probably know. You live there, right?
Forever,
right? So it's very hard to get.
I do more now when I go in on a business trip than I do when I live there. Because if you live there, you can't pay rent and eat.
Right. I mean, it's expensive. So I'm thinking, if I do move, I'll move somewhere, maybe like Philadelphia or
where you can just commute right in.
Right, somewhere that's like I have to be able to fit all my pianos in my.
How many do you have?
Just three acoustic pianos right now, but I have lots of Hammond organs and keyboards and Fender Rhodes and Wurlitzer and.
Are you backed by somebody right now?
As far as endorsed by?
Yeah.
No, I would love to be endorsed by.
Who would you like to be endorsed by if you had your wish?
Steinway.
Make sure that we get that out to them.
Well, I love Steinways. I mean, the first Steinway I ever played was in my one of my music teacher's house. Not Myra Boitis, but the classical guy that I took lessons from, Charles Day, was
and
a Juilliard graduate.
You.
I was actually mad when I got home. I'm like, you didn't tell me that's what real pianos would sound like. I was like mad at my mom, and she's like, oh brother, you know. It was hilarious, but it was a revelation, and throughout my whole musical life, like, just Steinways that's always calling my name.
They have a remarkable sound. I mean, there's a reason that people are addicted to them.
Yeah, the depth of tone, and just you can get like. Whatever sound you want. In fact,
is there someone that you've always wanted to play with that you haven't played with yet?
Well, you know, one thing I had always wanted to do, and it's too late now, I always loved Mary McPartland's show. I wanted to be a guest on her show, but, and then my friend said I should start my own show and then I could be Mary, and I'm like, oh, that would be really fun. So as far as, there's so many people I haven't played with, so I'm just, you know,
exploring.
You've
played with some pretty amazing legends, though.
I've been super lucky and blessed to get to play with, like, I mean, David Fathead Newman, Frank Morgan. Yeah, there's a list of people that have been wonderful. Most recently, Ken Poplowski, I got to play with him. He's a Clevelander.
And that was at that at Nighttown?
Actually, the first time was here at Blue Jazz. So we totally hit it off, and we've been playing together a little bit since then. And
You've recorded also, right?
Yes.
The first time I
saw
you...
Not with Ken, but...
You have recorded, though. I know you recorded at Velvet Tango Room.
Actually, no.
I thought you recorded...